Good morning, everybody. I understand that was a little surprising to hear. Morning, good morning. Good morning, everybody. Good, good. Why don't I request all of you to stand up if you can, please? Why don't you stand up today? It's a great opportunity while you're standing up to go ahead and meet somebody new. So if you can come forward, go ahead, meet somebody. If you're seated forward, please go ahead, meet somebody. Meet somebody and say, hi, nice to meet you. Or maybe, you know, they'd want a prayer request, so you can tell them, hi, can I pray for you or bless them? Lord bless you. Yeah, maybe appropriate blessings. May you have many children, sure. Use that appropriately. Go ahead. Good. If you're seated behind again, I would request you to come forward. If you've not still met somebody, go ahead. Please meet somebody new. Say, hi, nice to meet you. I'm so glad to be with you. Good, 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 good. Nice, 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 nice. How many of you are doing okay today? Not too good. Not too good. How many of you are doing great today? Great. Yeah, absolutely. Yes. How many of you are doing, you know, why I ask okay first is because sometimes we come to church because we're not okay. If we're okay, sometimes we're okay to watch online service, which is, we understand. But good, good, good. I'm happy you are here today. Why don't we pray and say, God, just want to thank you so much for the joy that is there just in coming into your presence, God. What joy fills our hearts, Father, today. Today, we want to just submit our lives into your hands, God. And may right now and our lives be just about you, Father. If there is one thing our lives could reflect, Father, let it be you, God, Jesus. Just like we read in science about the moon reflecting the sun's light, Father. If the moon had one job, which was to reflect the sun's light, Father, may we also reflect the sun's light today, Father, in this world. We pray and thank you so much for this time, and may your name be glorified in everything we do and say, God. We love you, we thank you, and we're excited to see what you're going to do today, God. We give you all the glory, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, everyone said, amen, amen. There you go. Let's go ahead and sing the song that we all know. Let's put our hands together and truly worship God today.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. We see you, we find strength to face the day. Sing your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. You know, sometimes with the busyness of life, we kind of lose the idea of why we pray. We kind of start to think that God is our personal genie. And he gives us 3 wishes. And the first wish that we ask him is, I want infinite wishes. So very smart like that. But when you read scriptures, it doesn't agree with that. When you read scriptures, it says, for by him all things were made. Through him all things were made. And it was for him. Colossians, you read it. It says, through him, by him, and for him. So the idea that he was made for us, like our prayers become, God, I need a promotion in my work. We wake up, God, I want you to bless this day. Or when we go through life, God, I need to get married. God, I need to go ahead and pass in my exams. God, I need this. God, I need that. God, I need this, that, this, that, this. But we don't realize that scripture never agrees or gives us a reason to ever go ahead and have that as a framework for life. In fact, scripture says we were made for Jesus. We were made for him. And so today, let that be a reminder as we pray that prayer, saying, God, we are for you, Father. We were made for you, oh God. And just like how you decorated this entire world, kept man, made that for man. When you made man, you realized that was made for you, God. And so today, I am here for you, God. Let's go ahead and sing that as a song, declare. May that be our prayer right now as we worship.
Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. just like we sang. Can we go ahead and pray that as well and say, God, to you our hearts are open today, Father. If there is anything, God, that is stopping me from worshiping you, Father, anything that is stopping me from living good lives, Father, and doing good deeds, Father, I pray, Father, that you would look into my heart and remove it, Father, we pray, God. If there is anything in my heart, Father, there's nothing hidden before you, Father. Even the darkest night is as bright as day to you, Father. What can I ever hide in my own eyes, Father? There is nothing hidden before you, Father. Even if I go to the depths of hell, God, you are there and your presence can be seen, Father. Even in the depths of hell, Father, you can still be seen, Father. That is how sovereign you are, God. Who can hide from your eyesight, my Father? Who can I hide from you, Father? Oh, nothing here is hidden, Father. To you our hearts are open. We sing again. To you our hearts are open. Nothing here is.
Lift our voices and tell him, God, you are Alpha and Omega, the first and last, the beginning and the end, God. You are the author of all creation. You are life itself, God. You are the Redeemer and Savior. Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, the Prince of Peace, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Jireh, you are. You are Elohim. El Shaddai, you are, Father. Come, God, Jesus. Come into my heart. Into my heart. Come into my heart. Lord Jesus, come in today, come in to stay, come into my heart, Lord Jesus, into my heart, into my heart, come into my heart, Lord Jesus, come in today, come in to
say, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. We pray and say, into my heart, into my heart, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in today, come in to say, come into my heart, Lord Jesus.
Come on, somebody pray and say, ask him. Come on, somebody pray and ask him, come into my heart, Jesus. But don't just come for this moment. Come and just stay, God. Tell him, Holy Spirit, come into my heart. Don't just come for a moment of maybe goosebumps. Don't just come in for a moment of just whispering something in my ears. Come and just stay, Jesus. Would you please come and just stay, Holy Spirit? Please come and just stay. Please don't go. Please don't leave us alone, God. You've promised in your word, Father, that you've not left us orphaned or as orphans, God. But you've put in us the spirit of sonship, a spirit by which we can call out to the Father, Abba. From the depths of our hearts, say, Abba. Abba, Father. Abba, meaning not just a father, not just a title, but a father who loves and cares. And a father who is so intimately involved with his children. A father who is capable of loving his children and caring for them. Abba, Abba. And so what we're lacking is not time, friends. What we're lacking is not money. Sometimes we even think the noble Christian thought of, if I had more money, I would do so much good deeds. What we're lacking is Jesus. What we're lacking is the Holy Spirit.
If you come, God,
Neer vandhaal soolnilai maarume, mudiyaadhum saathiyamaagum.
Come on, somebody sing with me and say,
Neer vandhaal soolnilai maarume, சாததும் சாத்தியமாகுமே நிறைவே நீர்வாருமே நிறைவே நீர் வேண்டுமே நிறைவே நீர் போதுமே ஆவியானவரே நிறைவே நீர்வாருமே
Scripture, it doesn't get clearer than that. When you read 1 Thessalonians 4 verses 3, it says, "For this is the will of God for you, just to be sanctified." In other words, sanctified meaning be holy and acceptable and pleasing to God. It doesn't get more clearer than that. This is the will of God for your life. Simple. Sanctified. Be holy just like God is holy. And in other words, it just means, just be like Christ, my friend. Be like Christ, my friend. And it's impossible to do that without Jesus. So if there's anyone among us who says, I want to be like Christ. I want to change my life. I want to truly live life that is holy, acceptable, that is pleasing to God. Because by the end of the day, it doesn't matter what my boss has rated me. It doesn't matter what he says about me. But what's going to matter is what God says about me. And so today I'm going to make that decision to really look up to God and say, God, I want to live holy lives, God. I want to live a holy life before you, Father. I want to live a life that is set apart, consecrated, Father, to you. Truly. Is anyone like that? Why don't you lift your hands up with me and let's pray together. Let's pray together and say, Father, you want to live a life where people mistake us for Christ, God. When they see NLAG as a church, may they mistake it for Christ himself. That the manifold wisdom of God has now been revealed, Father, through the lives that we live, God. May they see that difference in the church, God. Not by the way that we do it, God, Jesus. Not by our unique selling proposition, what we bring different to the table, God. But simply by the love that we share, by the love that we carry, Father. May they know that there is Jesus in this church. May they know there is Jesus in our families by the love that we carry, God. And for that, we need transformed lives. We need lives that are transformed, Father. Won't you transform us, Father? Let's pray for our church, because we're praying that this season we truly be seen as a church, as a community that loves. It's a community of love. And it's impossible to do it without God. It's impossible to do it without the Holy Spirit. Can we ask Him, Father, come fill us as a church, bind us, unite us with your love, God. We don't want to be found outside of your will. We don't want to be found outside of your love. But we also don't want to be found as unproductive branches, as unfruitful branches that don't bear any fruit in season and out of season and every season. No season do we bear fruit, Father. We don't want to be found like that, Father. Because your word says, Father, such branches are cut and thrown into the fire. We don't want to be found as such branches or trees that don't bear fruit, God. You want to be trees that bear fruit. You want to be fruitful, Father. You want to do something with the love that we receive, God. So also pray for our elections that's happening across our nation. Father, we pray, God, and thank you, God, for leaders. And your word says all authority is placed by God. We submit to that statement, Father. But what we pray for, God, is that all of it happens within your will, Father. And we submit our minds to your sovereign will, Father. When your word says in Daniel 4, it says, who could ever look to God and say, why did you do that? He does as he pleases with the people of this world and the things of heaven. He does as he pleases. Who could ever turn to him and say, why did you do that? We submit to your sovereign will, Father. We submit to your sovereign will where you do as you please. We submit knowing that you're a good God. When the word says that you're a God who has plans that are to prosper and not to harm. When the word says that you are good and that you are love itself, God. We submit knowing that you are that God. That's why we submit, God. We don't blindly submit to you, Father. We don't even blindly believe, God. We believe because we see it to be true. The evidence are just n number, Father. We don't just blindly believe, God. We believe because you are true. Because you've given us evidence for it, Father. So many evidences. So let us not be blinded by this world. That's what we ask, God. And so today, Father, if for the early Christians, the first century of Christians, the government and politics was never a factor for the church to thrive, may it not be a factor today for the church to thrive, Jesus. May we not look to the government to say, we have a good government, the church will thrive. No, God, that was never the picture, Father. That's not what we see in your word. That's not what we see in history. So may the church of Christ thrive under every government, we pray, Father. Let it thrive because the kingdom that the church belongs to is not the kingdom of this world, God. Neither do we belong to a kingdom of this world, God. We belong to a kingdom of light, a kingdom which is eternal, a kingdom which will not perish after this generation. And so may the church belong to the kingdom of light. May the church thrive, I pray, in every political scenario. May it thrive, Father, we pray. May the church thrive and multiply. We thank you for the elections, Father. May there be order that is set. And may there be Christian principles that we see
out of which law is birthed out of, Father, in this nation, in a nation where idolatry is glorified, Father, and idols are magnified, God. May we see Christian principles rise. May we see truth stand up, God, and set itself up for itself. Let's also pray for a couple of people who've requested for prayers. Let's pray for Sister Rabia, who's got colon cancer. They're planning for a chemo and surgery. Let's pray for Sam John, who's undergoing dialysis. His saturation levels are low. Let's pray for Ramesh, who suffered a stroke due to blood clot in his heart. Let's pray for Jeshwin. Jeshwin, who's 45 days old. 45 days old baby, who's got two holes in his heart. The family is, they're unbelievers. They don't know Jesus. And so they don't have any hope for the baby. Quite honestly, they don't have any other hope. But today we want to believe for a healing, for Jesus to come through, for salvation, that God, somehow in your sovereign will, Father, may Jeswin's testimony be the reason for their family to come to Jesus, Father. That's our prayer, Father. Whether that's what you want to do or not, God, that's our prayer today. May Jeshwin's testimony be the reason for their family's salvation, Father. That's what we pray, God. May this 45-day-old baby be healed completely. Completely, Father, in a way that only Jesus can heal. And may they know that it's not any God who's saved, God. Not even witchcraft for that matter. But may it be Jesus, Father. And may it be ever true, we pray, God. That's our prayer, Father. Let's also pray for Akash, who's undergoing treatment for myeloma. Let's also pray for Shikhar, who's 17 years old. He's having cancer in his brain tumor. Let's also pray for Irene, who's aged 73 years old, last stages of dementia. Pray that God will heal her. Let's also pray for Brother Moses, who's aged 60, suffering from a cancer. Let's pray for his healing as well. Let's pray for Brother Bharat, who's having multiple complications with respect to health and pain all over. He's diagnosed with muscle tension and nerve pull. Let's pray for Brother Satyan's hand and leg, which is paralyzed. He's 39 years old. Please pray for him. So many requests, I know. But whatever comes to your mind, I'm going to request that you pray. Pray to a Father who is good. Pray to a Father who is loving. Forget about your troubles for some time. Let's just close our eyes and remember these brothers and sisters who are in prayer, especially our dear son Jeshwin, 45 days old. Let's just remember him. Let's just pray. Let's lift up our voices. Come on, let's lift up our voices. Say, Father, we pray against cancer. We pray for healing, Jesus, yes. We pray for deliverance, Father. We pray for salvation, Father God, yes. We pray for curses to be broken. We pray for bondages to be broken. We pray for miracles. We pray for finance to be opened up, Father. You are Jehovah Jireh. Would you not provide for your children, Father? Would you not prove yourself to be Jehovah Jireh? Would you not prove yourself to be the God who sees? Jehovah, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nissi, El Shaddai, El Elohim, El Elyon. Nireve, Nirvarume, Nireve, Nirvendume, Nireve, Nirpodume. Let's pray for one more thing, okay? If there are fathers and mothers among us, I'm going to request that you listen attentively. Let's pray for godly family order to be restored in our families. You know, I pray that we'd see with our own eyes families
where we get time for kids to sit around the Father and for fathers to truly talk to kids about the scripture and teach them what scripture is teaching. I really pray for times where among us, our families, our fathers have kids sitting around them to teach them what the scripture says, to teach them biblical truths, to teach them what the gospel is, what baptism is, what it means to stand for Christ. That there will be times for fathers to have with their children, for mothers to truly nurture families, because they're so caught up with the busyness of life. We're so caught up, mothers especially. We see mothers going for work and truly slogging it out like fathers and spending hours together. Because if the mothers don't earn, sometimes the fathers are not there to earn. We don't have a strong father figure with foundational Christian principles. So the mother has to step in. So the mother has to step in and the mother has to do what she has to do. But in running, the mother loses out in nurturing the kids and giving emotional support to the children. Can we truly pray and say, Father, you want godly orders to be set, Father, amidst the busyness of this life. Somehow help us to make that time, reprioritize our lives, refocus our lives, Father, on you, Father. Help us understand the very reason for why we exist, to be Christ and nothing else, God. I pray, Father, godly fathers would rise up. Godly mothers would rise up. Godly families will be established on the word of God. That you would give us more times to talk to our children and to spend time with our children, to truly talk about scripture, truly enrich their lives on what matters more. I pray you would help us, Father. Flow through our houses, Holy Spirit, and order it, God. Just like you were flowing over the waters, God. And amidst that darkness and void, God, you were able to flow over it, God, and bring life and build purpose, Father. Help us as parents to build purpose into our kids' lives, Father. That's the kind of authority you've given. Help us as parents to truly build purpose into our kids' lives, God. We love you. We thank you for this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, everyone said, amen. Let's give God a big hand of praise. You may all be seated. Thank you, God, for this time.
VBS Scuba was a week of diving to learn about friendship with God through engaging Bible lessons, fun-filled games, creative crafts, and life skill lessons. It was a week of learning valuable lessons and forming lasting friendships. We thank the entire church who prayed diligently for us and the volunteers who served cheerfully. Thank you for making an impact in our next generation.
Kind attention, dear parents. Please note that our kids' service will go on a summer break from April 28th and will resume on the 9th of June. Dear kids, stay safe and enjoy your summer. Every month on the 1st, as a family in Christ, we come together to begin the new month in prayer and seeking God's favor and blessings. So join with us, church, for prayer on May 1st at 6 a.m. via Zoom. Please take note of the Zoom details displayed on the screen or reach out to our help desk for more details. How many of us believe that we should be lifting our hands in prayer to God for our children? The prayer guide for the month of May is dedicated to children and it will be available for download from the 1st of May. Please make use of it during your personal and community prayer times. Baptism classes happens every Sunday. If you would like to take this important step of water baptism, please reach out to our help desk today. Please note, a marriage bureau will be on summer break for the month of May and will resume on the 1st of June. For more details, updates, and for online giving, log on to bit.ly/NLEG community.
So last week we had VBS for all 5 days. Even yesterday we had the final day of VBS. So 6 days of VBS like we saw. We had a lot of fun, and kids I'm sure also had a lot of fun. So you might have heard already from your own children. But right now we thought it was appropriate, since we are fresh out of VBS, to go ahead and sing the VBS theme song as the offering song. And so I'm going to request, if there are kids among us, I'm going to request who have attended VBS, didn't attend also, sure, no problem, why not? You could send them forward, and if kids, you can come forward, sing the VBS theme song with us. It'll really be great. So please, let's put our hands together for our children. Welcome them. Yeah. Come. Don't be shy at all. In fact, we're sorry. I think all 6 days we sang this song, and we bothered them with singing this. Seventh day also, I'm sorry, guys. We're bothering you again. But I'm sure they loved this song, really. Every time we sang it, they were so excited. Yes, Anna, yeah, see what I said. See, look. Hey, again, we've not set up any of this. You know, he's doing it by his own will, free will. So any more children, please encourage your children to come forward to stand. Good? Anybody? Hey, you guys, you can come to the center. Don't be shy. Don't worry. Come. Good. Hey, come, you guys. Come, don't worry. Good. Good. So, kids, are you guys ready to sing the theme song? Yes, Anna, thank you. Okay, that was okay-ish, but that's not how we do. Are you ready to do the theme song? No, I don't think that's enough. Are you ready to do the theme song? Yes, okay. Parents, I hope you're ready. I request the ushers to take up the offering at this point.
Thanks, God, for all the good things you do. Thanks, God. You're my light and my truth. Oh, thanks, God, for all the good things you made. Thanks, God, for this heart that was saved.
Thank you, kids. You can be seated. We've got one video for all of you to watch.
Ooh, what's this? For me? But I don't remember ordering anything online, and you never give my office address. Well, let's see what this is. Not a road bustling with haste, but a route where choices are faced. What am I? Who kept it? Wait, where's everyone? What's going on? Yes, this journey can get lonely because only a few find it.
Morning, church. That's like people who didn't have breakfast, I guess. Good morning. Okay, so the last week, you know, as you've heard, we had VBS. There were so many people who helped with it. So many volunteers, so many teachers, so many people who spent like nights to put up the props and all of that. Can we give a big hand to all those people? You know, some of you gave cheerfully, some of you prayed very sincerely. Thank you to all of you for all you did for our kids. And I want to remind you that the children are not tomorrow's church. Children are the church. They are part of the church. They are part of the family. So this morning, in the other centers, I've been talking on Isaiah, doing a series on Isaiah. But here, I'm doing something else this morning. So before I begin, if any of you, since this is my first time here, if any of you don't know me, that would be a shame because I've been here for 17 years. I literally grew up in this church. So if you don't know me, that would be a shame. So I'm Matthew. I'm a software developer. I take a couple of life groups and also deal with a lot of things with the youth in our church. And I'm so happy to be sharing God's word with you all this morning. So every year when I read the Bible, I try to read it cover to cover, and when I come to this particular section in the Bible, it intrigues me so much because it has stories of obedience, disobedience, love, hate, treachery, whatnot. It is so packed with drama, inviting you into the story. And of course, if you haven't guessed, I'm talking about the books of 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel. Because the stories are so interesting and it kind of pulls you into the narrative. Now, for us, these are history books, but actually the book of 1 Samuel and also Joshua and Kings and Samuel are actually part of the prophetic literature in the Hebrew Bible. So the Hebrew Bible, which is called the Tanakh, has the Torah, Nevi'im, and Ketuvim, the law, the prophets, and the writings. So the book of Samuel is actually part of the prophets. Not history literature. The reason is because this is not history for the sake of history, but this is a prophet writing the story of Israel from God's perspective. And that is why it is a history book. And for a lot of us, these are disconnected stories. We know the story of Moses here. We know the story of David here. And a little bit of stories here and there. But the Bible is one coherent story. So this morning, we're going to study the book of 1 Samuel. We're going to cover the whole book of 1 Samuel and condense the whole message of 1 Samuel and try to do that in this one sermon. So just a bit of context as to what this book of 1 Samuel is about. I'm just going to paint a little bit of context before we dive into the book. So God chooses Abraham and says that through you, I will bless the nations of the earth, and from him come the nation of Israel. And the people of Israel end up in captivity in Egypt, and God delivers them out of slavery and he leads them to the promised land. And Moses leads them, and then after him, Joshua, and then there are many other judges who rule the people of, guide the people of Israel. And after that, only after that, we come to the monarchy where the kings start ruling. And the book of Judges was one of the darkest periods of Israel's history, right? So we read stories like a man cuts his wife into pieces and sends to every tribe of Israel. And another story where a woman drives a tent peg through the temple of a man. I mean, Judges is not a book you would read to your children at bedtime. And it is like an R-rated novel. And but the last judge was one of the greatest prophets of Israel. Who was the last judge? Anybody remember? Who was the last judge of Israel? Samuel. Samuel was the last judge. And during the time of Samuel, the people ask for a king. And that's where we're going to start. 1 Samuel chapter 8, verses 4 to 7. Let's read together. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. They said to him, "You are old, and your sons do not follow your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have." But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," this displeased Samuel. So he prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king." So people said, "We want a king like all the other nations." So God treats that as them rejecting him. So we need to understand, asking for the king in itself was not the issue there. But the heart, their heart's condition underlying that request was the real problem. You see, the God-appointed judge, when the judges ruled over, like say, Moses or Joshua, when a judge ruled over the people of Israel, it is not them ruling. It was God's instruction these judges take and they pass it on to the people of Israel. So to be led by a God-appointed judge meant to get their act right and to obey God and follow his ways. And they said, we don't want all that business. Because if you look at the book of Judges, the people, they sin against God and they end up in servitude to other nations because of their sin. And when they're in captivity, they cry out to God for mercy. God raises a judge. This judge saves them. And once life is comfortable, they go back in the same cycle. And this cycle repeats for almost 14 times in the book of Judges. And it's like, we don't want all of this. Forget, you know, a God leading us through a judge and telling us what to do. And when we don't obey, having these consequences, all that. Let's forget all of that. Let's have a king like every other nation around us. You know, we will have a big, strong king. He will fight the battles. He will make sure our nation is right. So give us a king like that. So underlying that request was the thing that they do not want God to tell them what to do. Because a human king, they can twist. A king is malleable, but they cannot twist God. God doesn't work like that. So asking king in itself was not the problem, but the underlying heart condition of the people that want to do away with God telling them what to do. Because way back in Deuteronomy, Moses already gives them instructions on what kind of king to appoint over the people of Israel. So these are the instructions for appointing a king. Moses gives them in Deuteronomy. The king should not consider himself better than the other Israelites. He should not run after wealth and money and horses and getting more wives. He should have a copy of the law always with him, read and meditate on it all his life, and follow the decrees of God. These are the instructions God already gave the people of Israel on how to appoint a king. So the problem was not asking for a king, but the underlying heart condition. So God grants their request, and Samuel appoints Saul as the king. And Saul was head and shoulders above everybody else. You know, he was this tall, handsome figure and all of that. And Saul actually started really well. He started really well. And in fact, in the beginning, he felt he was too small and insignificant to be a king. When Samuel looked for Saul, Saul was hiding among the supplies. So he felt he was too small. He was humble and all of that. He had a right attitude when he became king. And it says that when Saul became king, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon Saul. And he even prophesied when he became king. And he received a new heart from God, it says in scripture. And not everybody liked Saul becoming king. Because he was a Benjamite. Benjamin is a 12th tribe. And they're like, hey, why, how come a Benjamite can rule over us, some people thought. And some of them didn't like a Benjamite becoming their king, the first king for that matter. And a little bit after that, the people of Jabesh-Gilead, so Jabesh-Gilead is the nation of Israel. If you see the map of the nation of Israel, you know, you have the Jordan River, and the left of the Jordan River is the majority of the land. You have 9.5 tribes and 2.5 tribes to the right of the Jordan. So this, the right of the Jordan, the tribes this side, there was a prominent city called Jabesh-Gilead, and they were attacked by the Ammonites, and Saul fights valiantly and rescues the people of Jabesh-Gilead. And people are so glad that we have a king who fights our battles with God's help and all of that. And that is when people say, bring to us the people who said Saul should not become king. We'll put them to death. But you know what Saul said? No, we are not going to put anybody to death. This is a new beginning. That was Saul when he started off. He had his heart in the right place. But then things went downhill and his heart became corrupted. And in fact, the downfall of Saul is revealed to us in three major incidents. And all these three major incidents come in three battle contexts where we see the heart of Saul slowly going downhill. And the first incident is at Gilgal. 1 Samuel chapter 13. Saul remains, shall we read it together? Saul remained at Gilgal, and all the troops with him were quaking with fear. He waited 7 days, the time set by Samuel, but Samuel did not come to Gilgal, and Saul's men began to scatter. So he said, bring me the burnt offering and the fellowship offerings. And Saul offered up the burnt offering. Just as he finished making the offering, Samuel arrived, and Saul went out to greet him. What have you done? Asked Samuel. Saul replied, when I saw that the men were scattering and that you did not come at the set time and the Philistines were assembling at Michmash, I thought, now the Philistines will come down against me at Gilgal, and I have not sought the Lord's favor, so I felt compelled to offer the burnt offering. And Samuel replies, you have done a foolish thing, Samuel said. You have not kept the command the Lord your God gave you. If you had, he would have established your kingdom over Israel for all time. What an amazing promise to Saul. But now your kingdom will not endure. The Lord has sought out a man after his own heart and appointed him ruler of his people because you have not kept the Lord's command. See, Saul was given a very clear instruction that Samuel would come. He said 7 days' time, and that Samuel would come and make the offering. And God made it very clear the duties of different roles. The three prominent roles were of the prophet, the priest, and the king. And the king was not supposed to do the priestly duties because a priest was... the priestly family was set apart by God as holy to do the priestly duties. And Samuel was supposed to make the offerings. Because, you know, whenever the king went out to battle, they went to their God, be it any nation, they went to their God, made the offerings before they went to battle. And so Samuel said that he will come and do the offerings. So, and Samuel was one of the rarest people in the Bible who played all three roles of a prophet, a priest, and a king, because he was also a judge. So people wait, the king and his army wait for, as it was coming close to the 7 days, people became restless and the army began to scatter and people began to go away. And Saul felt insecure. Hey, I am the king, I am the boss. People cannot just leave like that. I can't let people scatter, you know, from my army and all of that. So I will offer the offerings. I will offer the burnt offering. And Saul goes ahead and offers the burnt offering, implying his pride. He was insecure. And then we see pride taking over and him offering the offerings, which only a priest would do. And then to top all of that, when Samuel came and confronted him, saying, hey, you did a foolish thing, instead of repenting and coming back to God, he started defending himself. You know, the enemy was coming, you did not come, the people were scattering. You know, when God confronts you, you just say sorry, you don't defend yourself. And Saul here was trying to defend himself. He was twisting his word instead of coming back to God with all his heart. So in summary, he was insecure. He was more concerned about his image before men than before God. He took the priesthood into his own hands, implying his pride. He defended himself and twisted his words instead of coming back to God with all his heart. You know, throughout this sermon, you know, whenever I'm listing these things, I might not directly sometimes ask you to think and reflect, but whatever the points that I put here for Saul or for David or whatever is put here, I want you to apply to yourself and also reflect on those things yourself as well. So now, let's go to the second incident. The first incident was at Gilgal, and the second incident is at Michmash, 1 Samuel chapter 14. Now, just a bit of a context before we read this. You see, the people of the Philistines were bitter enemies with the nation of Israel for a very, very, very long time. In fact, if you look at history, about in the first century AD, and even in the second century AD as well, when the Jews revolted against the Romans, and the Romans crushed the Jews, and they renamed the nation of Israel as Palestine as an insult by renaming it after their arch enemy, which is the people of the Philistines, which is the same as Palestine. So they were bitter enemies. And so in this particular incident, 1 Samuel chapter 14, Saul was going against a battle against Philistines, and he was like, at any cost, we got to win this battle. And until we win this battle, I'm not going to eat anything. And he says that none of you, the army also, are supposed to eat anything. And he puts an oath on them. He makes them take an oath that they would not eat anything as well. I mean, can you imagine going to battle without eating? You know, sharing the word in three services itself, I felt so tired. At 11 o'clock, I called my life group person to bring meal for me. I imagine going to a battle without food. It is difficult, right? So, and that is what Saul places an oath on his army. So, and that is the context with which we'll read this particular passage. The entire army entered the woods, and there was honey on the ground. When they went into the woods, they saw the honey oozing out, yet no one put his hand to his mouth because they feared the oath. But Jonathan had not heard that his father had bound the people with the oath, so he reached out the end of the staff that was in his hand and dipped it into the honeycomb. And there are many verses after that. We will not read all of that. So Jonathan was not aware of the oath. He goes and takes the honeycomb and he eats, and his eyes were brightened, it says, if you read, meaning that his strength was recovered. And after that, he infiltrates into the Philistine camp, and he defeats them, and the entire Israelite army joins with him, and they pursue the people of the Philistines and defeat them. And then after that, they take the cattle and the sheep from the plunder, and they butcher them on the ground and start eating, because they were so absolutely famished and hungry after the battle. Imagine. And they started eating, and they threw out their kosher dietary laws. And they were not keeping the law. And so people went and complained to Saul. And Saul said, hey, do not sin against the Lord. So he prepares a rock where they could offer these animals. And then they went and removed the blood from the animal and ate. So, like, think about this incident, right? Saul was a driven man who put others at risk for his own ambitions. Shall we bring up this slide? Saul was a driven man who put others at risk for his own ambitions. And to top that, when Saul came to know that Jonathan has eaten the honey and all that, he said, Jonathan broke the oath, he must die. Imagine, because of him, they won the battle that day. And he's saying, Jonathan must die. His mad drivenness clouded his reason. many times. And some of us can get into this driven attitude for our own ambitions, whatever that is. We can get into this. This whole world we are living in today is a very rat race, the culture. And sometimes this mad drivenness can cloud our reason, and we might even put our family at risk. So, and we are not called to be driven people. We are called people. Amen. We are not driven people in a mad driven race in the world, but we are called people. So now let's go to the third incident in the life of Saul. This is about destroying the Amalekites in 1 Samuel chapter 15. Let's read it together. Samuel said to Saul, "I am the one the Lord sent to anoint you king over his people Israel. So listen now to the message from the Lord. This is what the Lord Almighty says. I will punish the Amalekites for what they did to Israel when they waylaid them as they came up from Egypt. Now go, attack the Amalekites and totally destroy all that belongs to them. Do not spare them. Put to death men and women, children and infants, cattle and sheep, camels and donkeys." You see, the people of Amalekites were very wicked people. God tells that in the next passage, we'll see. When the people of Israel came out from Egypt and they were going to the promised land, at one point, they did not have water and they were extremely tired. And this is not just an army, right? You have women, children, cattle, livestock. And in such a vulnerable condition of the whole people of Israel, the Amalekites unprovoked come and attack those vulnerable Israelites from behind. And that is the kind of people they were. And God, Moses, right then itself in Exodus, he says, God is going to blot out the name of Amalek from under the earth. And now, when Saul becomes king, God is fulfilling that word and is saying, go attack the Amalekites and destroy them. And go. And so Saul goes and he wins the battle and all of that. But he spares all the good sheep and the good cattle because he says his army didn't want to, you know, let go of this good sheep and cattle, all that. Let's read that. The next, from verses 17 to 21. Samuel said, "Although you were once small in your own eyes, did you not become the head of the tribes of Israel? The Lord anointed you king over Israel, and he sent you on a mission saying, go and completely destroy these wicked people, the Amalekites. Wage war against them until you have wiped them out. Why did you not obey the Lord? Why did you pounce on the plunder and do evil in the eyes of the Lord?" And Saul replied, "But I did obey the Lord. I went on the mission the Lord assigned me. I completely destroyed the Amalekites and brought back Agag their king. The soldiers took the sheep and cattle from the plunder, the best of what was devoted to God, in order to sacrifice them to the Lord your God at Gilgal." The soldiers took it, and what do we want to do? We want to give it as offering to God. And this is what Samuel replies, "Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams. For rebellion is like the sin of divination, and arrogance like the evil of idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you as king." You see, Saul considered the opinions of others more important than that of God. Because the people felt that, you know, we should not destroy the good, nice-looking sheep and all that. And he said, okay, let's not destroy them. Sometimes we are like that. When God tells us to do them, we obey a lot of things. But when something is appealing to us, looking good to us, we are like, okay, maybe this I will not. Now we know that sometimes, you know, we are not supposed to be unequally yoked to an unbeliever. And so you're attracted to this person who is not a believer. And you're like, but Lord, isn't she a little cute? Just like what Saul said, they're good looking, healthy looking animal cattle. How can I offer them? And he said, the reason I spared them is to offer to the Lord. He placed more value on religious ritual over a personal relationship with God. he was too preoccupied with his image before people than before a holy God, trying to please them, what they want. And again, the same thing. Instead of repenting, he again defended himself. So what happens is, after this whole incident, Samuel was very upset with Saul, and he walks off. And Saul, you know what Saul says? He says, hey, I'm sorry, I've done wrong. Please come and honor me before the people. His whole worry was that Samuel would come and offer the offerings so that people would think that he is still king and everything is good with him. He was more concerned about Samuel coming back and honoring him before people than truly repenting. You see, repentance is not just about saying sorry. Saul said, hey, yeah, after all his defense, he said, yeah, I'm sorry, I did wrong. But repentance is not just about saying sorry, but it is coming back to God with all your heart and building that relationship again. I mean, imagine if you caused a deep hurt to your spouse, right? It is not just about, hey, I'm sorry, and just getting along. It is to look into your heart and say, hey, where have I gone wrong? Why did I behave this way? I'm going to put new boundaries that this won't happen again. And then you build the trust and the relationship once again. That is what true repentance looks like. But what Saul is doing here is that, hey, I'm sorry, can we get along? So repentance is not about just saying sorry, but it is coming back to God. Shall we put that on the slide? Repentance is not about just saying sorry, but coming back to God with all your heart and building the relationship. So in summary, Saul was a driven man who put others at risk for his own ambitions. His mad drivenness clouded his reason many times. He was more concerned about his image before men than before God. He took the priesthood into his own hands, implying his pride. He defended himself and twisted his words instead of coming with all his heart before God. He considered the opinions of others and what they thought more than that of God. He placed value on religious ritual over a personal relationship with God. And sometimes we could be like that. You know, coming to church or a life group or attending this and this are more important than a relationship with God. We want a good image before a good church-going guy than a personal relationship with God. And he was too preoccupied with his image before people than before a holy God. Power corrupted a man who was once small in his own eyes, to the point that Samuel was sure that he would even kill him. You see, when God told Samuel, go to Bethlehem and anoint David, you know what Samuel said? If Saul comes to know of this, he's going to kill me. That is the extent to which Saul was corrupted. And God rejected Saul and gave the kingdom over to one of his neighbors, which is David. You see, when Samuel went to anoint David, God did not tell the name. God did not tell, go anoint David. He said, go to Bethlehem, go to the family of Jesse, and I will tell you who to anoint as king. So, you know, Samuel already had the experience, because Saul was head and shoulders tall above everybody. So he thought God will again choose somebody who is very tall and handsome and good looking and all of that. So when the sons of Jesse came, he thought, okay, this guy is like very tall and, you know, head and shoulders above everyone. Probably this is the guy. And God said, no, do not look at the appearance, because God does not look at the outward appearance, but he looks at the heart. And this is the key thing here. If David was a man after God's own heart, Saul was a man after man's own heart. Because that is what they wanted, a big, tall, strong guy who will lead us in our battles and keep our nation safe. He was a man after man's own heart. And when you seek a man after man's own heart, that man also is going to be a man after man's own heart to please people, to save his image and all of that. And that was the man that Saul was. If David was a man after God's own heart, Saul was a man after man's own heart. Saul stood for what people wanted. David represented what God desired. Saul was corrupt to the point of opening door for evil spirits. He kept hardening his heart till the point that he opened door for evil spirits. And even after that, he sought human remedies. Then coming back to God with all his heart, he said, bring me a harpist so that when he plays music, I can feel better. Instead of repenting and coming back to God, he sought human remedies. And he became very insecure and jealous about David. Insecurity and jealousy rots the human heart. And right from the beginning, when they said Saul killed his thousands, but David his 10,000s, right from then, insecurity and jealousy has corrupted this man's heart. And this in many ways is to be expected, given what we see of him in the previous passages. You know, sometimes we think, you know, God was more partial to David than to Saul. David did worse things too, but let me change your mind. Saul was relentless in his pursuit to kill David. Let me read out a few things here. He wanted to kill the best man in his army, the one who risked his own life to save Israel against the Philistines, David. He hurled a spear at David, right, when he was playing the harp. He sent David on dangerous missions, thinking that some other army will kill David. He sent men to David's home itself to kill him. He hunted him down throughout Israel incessantly. He had informants everywhere to inform about David. He killed an entire priestly family, not for helping David, but for a suspicion of helping David. An entire priestly family at a place called Nob. He was relentless even after David spared Saul's life twice. That's the amount to which his heart was corrupt. And on the contrary, next slide, David knew the God he served, that he was the living God. You know, when he went in this battle against Goliath, he said that, you know, you come to me with your spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the living God. Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defile the armies of God? I mean, he's like, we serve the living God. David knew the God he served. And his life won the respect of his brothers who once despised him. You know, his brothers, when David goes to give lunchbox to his brothers, they say, hey, where did you leave those few sheep of yours? What are you? You came to see the drama of the battle here? You know, that's how his brothers treated. But we see in the later passages, his brothers, when David was on the run from Saul, that's where our title comes from. David was on the run from Saul. He was in hiding. When David was on the run and he was in hiding, his brothers come and join along with David's group. So he won the respect of his brothers. And David cared for his own people while Saul tried to kill his own son for his ambitions. Because David, he seeks asylum for his parents. You know, since he was on the run, he couldn't take care of his parents. You know, what if somebody harms him? What if Saul harms his parents? So what he does is he takes his parents and seeks asylum in Moab. Why Moab? Probably because his great-grandmother Ruth is from Moab. We don't know why he went to Moab, but probably that's one reason. And so David cared for his own while Saul tried to kill his own son. And David always committed himself to the Lord. He said, the Lord will protect. He has promised me. He has led me. He is going to protect me. And God did not, and it many times, repeatedly you will see this verse, but the Lord did not give him into the hands of Saul. And I want to tell you, when God has purposes for your life, no man can stop that. When Jesus was in his earthly ministry, many times people tried to kill him. What did he say? My time has not yet come. When God has purposes for your life, even if the greatest person, who is greater than the king of Israel in Israel, right? Even when the king of Israel, when he relentlessly pursues to kill David, still he couldn't do anything because the Lord did not give him into the hands of Saul. When you commit yourself into the hands of God and not worry about people's opinions, whatever, God is your protector. God fights your battles and God is behind you. And Abigail makes this beautiful, beautiful statement to David. She says, even though a man is trying to kill you relentlessly, the Lord has bound your life securely in the bundle of the living. What a beautiful statement she makes to David. The Lord has bound your life securely in the bundle of the living. That's what God did to David because he trusted God. And let's move on. David did not worry about people's opinions. His first allegiance was always to God. Now, at one point when he was on the run, he wanted to rescue this people of Keilah against the Philistines. They were in trouble. And his men were like, hey, you yourself are in trouble running away. Why do you want to go and rescue these people? But he was like, no. And he consults God and God tells him, go and rescue these people. So David was not coerced by the people's opinions. And when he had a chance to kill Saul in a cave, and he says, I will not lay my hand on the Lord's anointed. He just cuts the robe of Saul. And even for that, he was conscience stricken that he cut the robe of Saul. And in another instance, in the desert of Ziph, David and Abishai go to Saul when he was not under his guard, on his guard. Saul was sleeping and all his army was sleeping around him. David and Abishai were there. I mean, imagine, your enemy is there, all asleep, he's in your hands. One thrust into his body, David's problems are over. I mean, if somebody tells you all your problems are done overnight, do this one thing, wouldn't you do that? He was running away all his life. He had one chance to end all his troubles. He tells Abishai, I'm not going to do that. Abishai tells him, kill him. I mean, he can reason it through saying that, Lord, he's trying to kill me unnecessarily. I mean, I have done no wrong. I have every right to kill him. He doesn't do that. He commits himself to the Lord. And another incident, when Saul was seeking asylum with the king of the Philistines, he was staying in the border of Judah and Philistia, which is Ziklag. And you know, he and his people, when they go out for some other battle, some raiders come and take all of David and his men's livestock and their property and their wives and children, everything, these raiders come and take away. And all the people who are with David, they want to kill David now and stone him to death. Why? We followed you and all this came upon us. We trusted you and followed you, and now we lost our wives, our children, our property, our livestock, everything is gone. But you know what? David, instead of feeling crushed and insecure and whatever, it says he encouraged himself in the Lord. He went to the Lord. He encouraged himself in the Lord. He pursues those people. He brings back all that was lost. And the people said, you know, some people go with him into the battle, and the others who complained stayed with the supplies. And the people who went to the battle said, don't give them the plunder. And David rebukes them and said, no. He made this rule that the people who went with to the battle and people who kept watch over the supplies get the same portion of the plunder. That was David. He didn't care about people's opinions. He knew, for him, his first allegiance was to God, and that he has to honor God and his what God wants him to. And you know what? Saul pursued David in spite of knowing fully well that David will become king. At one point when David spares Saul's life, Saul calls out to David and says, hey, my son David, I know that you will become the king of Israel one day. And when you become king, show mercy to my family. He knows fully well that David was certainly going to become king. And yet he hardens his heart and tries to kill David. And that is the biggest difference between Saul and John the Baptist. John the Baptist, when Jesus came on the scene, what did he say? He must increase and I must decrease. You know, Saul could have taken that route and say, hey, David, you're my son-in-law. You know, David was his son-in-law. He could have said, you know, I want to help you how to become a good king. I made some mistakes. Make sure you don't do the same mistakes. And he could have guided David and helped him, you know, and let him increase and he decrease. But he did not do that. And the height of David's pain is revealed in this particular passage. I'm going to read that. This is one of the saddest passages or one of the saddest verses in the book of 1 Samuel. And this is what it says. 1 Samuel chapter 26, 19 to 20. David is saying to Saul, shall we read that? If we bring that up on the screen. Yeah, this is what David tells to Saul. Now, let my Lord the king listen to his servant's words. if the Lord has incited you against me, then may he accept an offering. I mean, if it is God who is sending you against me, then let us go, let us settle the matter, and we'll give an offering to the Lord. But if people have incited you against me for whatever reason, because there is no reason for you to come against me, then may they be cursed. They have driven me today from my share in the Lord's inheritance and have said, go serve other gods. Now do not let my blood fall to the ground far from the presence of the Lord. The king of Israel has come out to look for a flea as one hunts a partridge in the mountains. That's very sad. Like, you see, for a Jew, for an Israelite, you know, his belongingness as part of the people of Israel and the land of Israel, it gives him a sense of identity. Because, you know, God promised this land to them, and they inherited this land, the nation of Israel, and the land was divided. This was the portion for Judah, and this was for the people of Bethlehem, and this is for the people of Jesse, and they took pride in the fact that God gave them this promised land, and they worshiped the Lord together and all of that, and now he's driven away from his inheritance and said, go serve other gods. Imagine how David would feel. I don't know if you're capturing this, but let me give you an example to understand what it means. You know, my grandfather, he has lived all his life in my village, right? He is a very inspirational guy. I mean, I look up to him so much. He passed away a few years back when he was close to 90. Now, he worked really hard all his life. He saved so much. I mean, he worked really, really hard all his life and made savings and bought some land and all of that and gave a good living for my dad and my uncles and aunt and all of that. So, and imagine the government comes to my grandpa and says, hey you, we're going to seize all your land, your property, your house, everything, and you're out. Imagine how he would feel. That is all he knew all his life. The people, the land, everything. And imagine he's on the road. That is what David felt. I'm being driven away today from my Lord's inheritance. Do not let my blood fall to the ground far from the presence of the Lord. That's a heartbreaking statement. And that's what happened to David. And Saul continued his resistance. And he became so stony-hearted that at the end of it, he even lost his relationship with the Lord. And in this final battle, he goes and seeks a sorcerer, a medium, a spiritist, in order to understand the course of action for the battle that he is going to fight against the Philistines. And in that battle, Saul loses his life in the battle. He was very badly wounded and almost in the pangs of death. And he falls. He knows that the Philistines, if they catch him, they're going to torture him. So he falls on his own sword and dies. What a tragic ending. Now, lest you think David was perfect, he was not. He went after his desires many times. You know, the man who wouldn't lay a hand on the Lord's anointed killed an innocent man, Uriah the Hittite, right? And the sin with Bathsheba weakened his moral position in his family. You know, when his sons messed up and did all kinds of nonsense, he could not correct his sons and set things right in his family. Probably because he lost his moral position in the family. They would have said, hey, David, look what you have done. You know, when the follow-up sermon to this on 2 Samuel, this whole thing is from 1 Samuel. In 2 Samuel, we will look at all these things. But, you know, but I just wanted to mention briefly that David wasn't perfect. He had all of this. He did not sternly settle the issues with his family. But David repented like his life depended on God. That is what David did. He threw his heart completely after God and gave himself fully after God. Even in his darkest moments, he sought the Lord. He could not even bear the fact that he could be away from God even for a moment. I mean, look at the Psalms. In everything he saw God. Probably when he was a shepherd boy, he wrote, the Lord is my shepherd. Just like I watch over the shepherd, the Lord watches over me. When he goes to the army with his army and all of that, he's like, the Lord is my shield. The Lord is my rock and my fortress. Just like a rock gives refuge to the army, in the same way, the Lord is my refuge and my fortress. With him, I can even scale a wall. Now that was David. In everything, he sought God, and he couldn't even bear the fact that for a moment he would be away from God. When Nathan rebukes David for that whole incident of Bathsheba, he repents. And out of that penitential psalm, we read the Psalm 51, which is such a beautiful psalm of what repentance ought to be like. And that was David. And most of the psalms that David has written were written when he was on the run from Saul, during some of the darkest moments of his life. And I want to end with this last slide. You see, David was on the run from Saul. David was on the run for many years before he became king. But the important thing was that he was on the run after God's own heart. Amen? Let me read that again. David was on the run for many years before he became king. But the important thing was that he was on the run after God's own heart. Shall we bow our heads in prayer? Father, we want to be people who run after your heart, Lord. We want to be people who run after your heart. We don't want to be people who are jealous, insecure. We don't want to think about people's opinions or value people's opinions above you, oh Father. We don't want to put value in a ritual, religious ritual, over a personal relationship with you, oh Father. We want to run after you, Jesus. We want to put our trust squarely in you, that when you have promised us, no man can hinder us. When you have led us, when you have called us, nothing is going to stop us from walking in your purposes, because you are our protector, you are our provision, you are our provider, and nothing is going to harm us. Father, so Lord, we don't want to be a man after man's own heart. The opinions of man, the thoughts of man. But Lord, we want to run after your heart. May it be said of us, this is a man after God's own heart. Shall we stand to our feet and sing this song? God, I'm running for your heart. I'm running for your heart.
Lord, let me burn for you again.
soul on fire, Lord, for you. We want to run after your heart, Jesus. We want to run after your heart, Lord. We want to be a man after your own heart. Doesn't matter if we get a crown. Doesn't matter if we have to run, even after the promise of being the king, if we had to run all our life, we will know that you have promised and you will bring it to pass, O Father. We will trust you with all our hearts, Lord. We thank you, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated for a minute. We want to welcome newcomers here. If any of you say this is your first time that you have come into this church, New Life Assemblies of God, English service, would you please slip up your hand? Okay, we have a couple of... Would you stand to your feet as well? We would like to welcome you. Come on, let's give a big hand to all of these people. Can I request one more thing? If you could come to the front, we all would like to pray for you as well. Come on, let's give a hand to these people. So we meet for three services, 7, 9, and 11 in this church. And if you're not part of any other church and you're in the city, we would be happy to have you in our church. Shall we stretch our hands towards these people and pray for them? Father, thank you, Lord, for these beautiful people who have walked into your sanctuary this morning. Father, I pray that you bless them. May they be people who would run after your heart, Lord. May they be people who would pursue you above all things. Lord, if there is anyone here, O Lord, who has not committed their life to you, I pray that they would make that decision today, because that would be a decision that they will never regret, O Father. I pray that you will meet their needs. I pray that you will guide them. I pray that if there is any sickness, that you would heal, O Father. I pray that you would be their Lord and the portion all the days of their life. And I pray that they would blossom and grow in your church and bear fruit, O Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. There are some leaders there who would take the forms and have a few minutes of chat with you and let you go. Please do meet them. Can we give a big hand to these people once again? Shall we all stand to our feet and pronounce God's blessing together? May the love of the Father, the grace of His only Son, Jesus, and the sweet communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forever. And all God's saints said, Amen. God bless you all. Have a fantastic week ahead. See you all next week.